Hey, praise the Lord. It's me again, Brother Clinton, and you're back on the Word Prophet channel, a Christian ministry dedicated to the purpose of teaching the Word of God to the people in the churches of God so that we can go back to serving God in spirit and in truth, as our Lord Jesus Christ commanded. I'd like to ask you, if you have your Holy Bible, King James Version, to turn with me to Deuteronomy and the 32nd chapter and the 17th verse. I have something that I'd like to share with you, which is going to be very profound. I'm not sure how long we're going to be here, but you know, because you can see how long this video is as you're watching it, but I don't know right now how long this video is going to be. But it's going to be as long as it needs to be in order for God to cause this message to come forth to those of you who love the Lord Jesus Christ. Those of you who love God and you believe His Word, this message is going to be of particular importance and blessing to you, because it's going to open up your understanding to some things that you may never have even thought about, that you may have seen all around you but never even bothered to say, hey, wait a minute, why is that? Where did that come from? Praise the Lord. We're going to look at where the gods came from. And when I say that, I'm not talking about the Lord our God. I'm talking about that which is referred to in the scripture as the gods. And so let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 17. Deuteronomy chapter 32 is a song that God gave to Moses to proclaim to Israel, to let them know that, well, to declare to them prophetically that after the departing of Moses, they would again depart from the Lord into idolatry. And that indeed happened. And so this is a prophetic song, chapter 32, which is a declaration to Israel before the fact, of the fact, that after the departing of Moses, they would turn away from the Lord their God and would turn to idols and to worshiping of devils. And so in verse 17, the scripture says, "They sacrificed unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not." Now, there's many times that this is spoken of all throughout the scripture, and we could go through all of them, but I don't want to make this video too super long. And so suffice it to say that the scripture speaks about entities that are called gods. And rightly so, because there are many things in the world that are called God. Even Paul wrote that in the New Testament. There be many that are called gods. But there is only one true and living God who created the heavens and the earth. But there are many that are called gods. And wherever you go, whatever culture you go to, whatever people you talk to, they all have stories about the gods that their forefathers used to worship and that many of them still worship today. Like, I grew up in Arizona, and I talked to many Native Americans in Arizona who told me traditions of the way that their fathers worshiped their gods. And some of them even called their gods God and associated their gods with the God of Israel, but they were certainly not the same thing at all. When I spoke to Native Americans, they told me about, I think they called them flesh walkers, and they were also shape changers. And there are people that have heard about traditions about what they call myths about werewolves and what's the, you know, the Loch Ness Monster and Bigfoot and things like that. And these are all things that people who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, they love to just look at videos about this and go, "Ooh, isn't that mysterious?" But really, it's not that mysterious if we read the scripture and we can understand exactly where these entities came from. And they're not myths at all. The reason that we were taught from our youth that these things are myths is because the globalist mafia of this world doesn't want us to know that these things are reality, which will cause us to go to the scripture and see that that is true, and also to see that Jesus Christ is the Lord and that we would come to Him and be saved from our sins. Praise the Lord. And so we're going to learn a little bit today about where the gods came from. Okay, every culture has their gods that they worshiped. Ancient Rome, ancient Greece, ancient Babylon, the Medes and the Persians, all the way back to the days of Nimrod, all the way back to basically the beginning of time as we know it. The people in every culture had their gods. And, you know, a long time I asked myself, or I asked the Lord, or asked myself in the presence of the Lord, or something like that, I said, where did the gods come from? Because, you know, the people, all these people say that they worship these gods. You know, the Mormons have their gods, the Jehovah's Witnesses have their gods, the Native Americans have their gods, the Roman Catholics have their gods. You know, the Greeks have their gods, the Babylonians have their gods, and so on and so forth. You know, the Assyrians and the Medes and the Persians and all that. And you know, it's obvious to me that all these people didn't just make this stuff up. You know, and if they did, I mean, if we can imagine that they did, how would that happen? I mean, just one day, some people were sitting around a campfire and they were just saying, you know, we need some gods. And they just made up some gods. You know, we need some gods. Yeah. What are we going to call them? Well, let's call them Jupiter and Saturn and whatever they, you know, whatever they called their gods, Pluto, you know. And no, it didn't happen like that. They didn't just one day just drink too much coffee, sit around a campfire, and say, you know what, we need some gods. That's not something that people just invent. Okay, the so-called myths about the gods, they came from somewhere. They came from somewhere, and that's what we're going to see as we look in the scripture. Praise the Lord. So come with me back to the very beginning, the Genesis. And when I say the Genesis, I say it that way on purpose because Genesis is a word that means the beginning. The Genesis is the beginning. And so if we go back to the Genesis, we can see in chapter 6, in the beginning of the chapter, it says, "And it came to pass when men," okay, let's just back up for a second. As we're reading the Genesis, what we are reading is Holy Scripture that was given by inspiration of God, that God gave to Moses, which was written by Moses concerning things that happened before Moses was ever born. Okay? Moses wasn't here to see these things. I should say he wasn't there to see these things that he wrote about. He wasn't even born when we read about the things that we read about in the book of Genesis, at least most of the book of Genesis. Moses wasn't even born, okay? And so, no, all the book of Genesis, in fact, forgive me. So these things were given by revelation to Moses from the Holy Ghost, which is God, the Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God gave these things to Moses, and Moses wrote them down. Moses had no way of knowing these things. Of course, he might have heard about some of these things from other people, you know, throughout history, but Moses wrote these things down by revelation from God. God told him what to write, and he wrote it. Okay? Word for word, exactly as God told him to write it. And we have it today translated for us in the English language. Those of us who are speaking English, you're listening to this video in English. So we're reading the King James Bible, which is the Word of God for those of us who speak English. And as you know, if you know anything about this ministry, and if you believe the Word of God, you know that any other Bible in the English language that is worded differently than this Bible is not the Word of God. And it cannot be the Word of God according to the Word of God, because all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for correction, for reproof, and for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto every good work. And so if that is true, which it is, then it remains so that it is not possible for two Bibles in any given language that say two different things to both be given by inspiration of God. So for those of us who speak English, the Holy Bible King James Version is the Word of God. Praise the Lord. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 6. And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair. Pardon me. And they took them wives of all which they chose. Pardon me. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth also in those days. And also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. Okay, let's just stop there. It says that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair. Okay, there are many people that like to argue about this, but there really is no argument. It doesn't say that the sons of men or the sons of Adam saw the daughters of men that they were fair. It says the sons of God. And the sons of God is a phrase that is used in the scripture to describe the people of Israel, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, Adam, and the angels. Okay, Adam was called a son of God, the son of God. Adam was called the son of God. in the first chapter of Matthew. Israel is called the sons of God. And the church of Jesus Christ is called the sons of God. And also angels are called the sons of God. And so in verse 2 here, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair. Well, this is not talking about Adam. And it's not talking about the children of Israel, because they didn't exist yet. And it's not talking about the church of Jesus Christ, because we hadn't existed yet. So it's talking about angels. The sons of God are the angels. And they saw the daughters of men that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. This is also written in the New Testament. If you'll come with me to 2 Peter. 2 Peter in the second chapter. It says, for if God spared, I'm in verse 4, 2 Peter 2:4. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing the flood upon the world of the ungodly, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those that after should live ungodly, and delivered just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelling among them, and seeing and hearing, vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations, and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. So Peter obviously said that God did not spare the angels that sinned. These angels were angels that sinned in the days of Noah, and they sinned after the same manner of the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, which is, of course, by sexual perversion. And it says, the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations, and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. Okay. Peter knew about these things, both from the book of Genesis and also from the book of Enoch. Okay. And if we go just a few pages over to Jude, we can see even more clearly. Jude, starting in verse... I'm in 3 John, that's why I'm not seeing it. Jude, starting in verse 6, it says, and the angels, which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day, even as Sodom and Gomorrah, and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication, and going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. So Peter and Jude, apostles of Jesus Christ, both wrote about this event that we just read about in Genesis chapter 6, wherein the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. Also, well, I want to share with you another portion of the scripture from Jude first. In Jude verse 14, the scripture says, and Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Okay, so it's evident from reading 2 Peter and also from reading Jude that Peter and Jude had read the book of Enoch, and they were quoting from the book of Enoch in the scripture. For example, in Enoch chapter 1, verse 9, it says, and behold, he cometh with 10,000s of his holy ones to execute judgment upon all, and to destroy all the ungodly, and to convict all flesh of all the works of their ungodliness which they have ungodly committed, and of all the hard things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Praise the Lord. Now, I just want to make a little parenthesis right now, because there are many of you who have asked me and are maybe asking right now, well, if you believe that Enoch is a prophecy from God, then why isn't it in the Bible? And the answer to that is something that I could take a while to explain, but in a nutshell, the books that are in the Bible are there on purpose, because the Bible is more than just the Bible. The words that we read in the Bible, the Holy Bible, are not all there is to the Bible, okay? There are things written in the Bible that we can't see. with our naked eyes, with our human eyes. In this book, the Holy Bible, is contained the names of everyone that has ever existed that God has ordained to enter into his kingdom. In this book, the Holy Bible, are written the works of all the wicked, everything that they have done all of their lives, and this is one of the books that shall be opened at the judgment to bear witness against the wicked of all their wicked works that they have done. There is much more to this holy book than just the words that we are able to read in the English language, having been translated into English. In the 80s or 90s, after the advent of computers, it was discovered by putting the Hebrew scriptures, well, actually the book of Genesis, into a computer and trying something called equidistant letter spacing, that there was things written in the scripture that we do not perceive, that the Jews did not perceive and had no way of perceiving when they would read the scripture in the synagogue every Sabbath day. There were things written in there that pertained to certain individuals that were born in our generation, or 100 years ago, or 200 or 300 years ago, and things that they did, and dates, and events. And they discovered that if they would take this equidistant letter spacing theory, and they would put, say they put the book of Genesis into a computer, and they were to take every seventh letter, it would tell them a story of people and events that have happened on the earth, but hadn't happened yet at the time that Genesis was written. And if they were to take every fifth letter, it would tell them a whole different series of events and names and stories. And every third letter, and so on and so forth. There is much more to the scripture than meets the eye. And that which meets the eye is that which God has intended to meet our eye, so that we can know about him, the doctrine of his son, Jesus Christ, how to be saved from our sins, and how to enter into his kingdom and avoid the wrath that is coming in the fire of hell, and also to know him. And God has ordained that that which meets our eye on the surface of this Holy Bible, even in the English language, when it wasn't originally written in English, would give us the revelation, the living revelation of who he is, and how we have been foreordained before the foundation of the world to be adopted into his family by his son, Jesus Christ. But yet, underneath, the underlying parts of this book, the things that are written in this book, are multitudes deeper than we can see. It's like this that we're reading in a book. It's like we're standing on the top of the highest mountain on the world, and we go to the top, and we bow down on the top of that mountain, and we pick up a little stone that will fit in our hand. That's the amount of revelation that we can actually get from reading the Word of God and understanding the things that God has given to us in his Word. And you and I know that those things are more than we can ever absorb in an entire lifetime. And yet underneath that little rock that we pick up, there's that huge mountain underneath us that goes not only all the way down to the ground, which we can barely see from the top, but also the foundation of that mountain goes underneath the ground, possibly as high as the mountain is itself, but underneath the ground. And so that is what the Holy Bible is, my brothers and my sisters. All the books that are in the Holy Bible are there on purpose. They're there in the order that they're in, on purpose, the purpose of God. And that's not to say that there isn't any other prophecy that isn't given from God. It's just to say that if there is another prophecy given, that it needs to be tried and tested by the Word of God. This is why the scripture says, prove all things, hold fast that which is good, and that ye may all prophesy one by one, that all may learn and all may be comforted. And so if there be any prophets among you, let them prophesy two or three, and that by course, and let the others judge. Okay, how do the others judge? By the scripture. We have something that we can use to judge anything that we see or hear in this world, to know whether or not it is true or false. You see, that's what the scripture is given to us for, and it is the way it is on purpose. And the books that are in it are there on purpose, and the books that are not in it are not in it on purpose. And just because a book isn't in the Bible doesn't mean that it can't be a true prophecy from God. Just because even today a man of God might write something prophetic It doesn't mean that God left it out of the Bible or that the Catholic Church took it out of the Bible. It just means that it's given by inspiration of God. We've proved it to be so by the scripture, but it's not in the Bible because the things that are in the Bible on purpose, because the Bible is much deeper than we can see. And it has a multitude of information and revelation that we in this flesh, in this life, will never have access to, that we will never be able to tap into. Okay, that's why the Bible is what it is, and that's why the Book of Enoch isn't in the Bible, even though I receive it as prophecy from God, and so did the apostles of Jesus Christ, because they quoted from this book in the letters of the New Testament. So, having said that, I want to open up to chapter 6 of the Book of Enoch, and I want to share something with you. It says, "And it came to pass when the children of men had multiplied that in those days there were born unto them beautiful and comely daughters. And the angels, the children of the heaven, saw and lusted after them, and said one to another, Come, let us choose wives from among the children of men, and beget us children. And Semjaza, who was their leader, said unto them, I fear you will not indeed agree to do this deed, and I alone shall have to pay the penalty of a great sin. And they all answered him and said, Let us all swear an oath and bind ourselves by mutual imprecations, not to abandon this plan, but to do this thing. Then swear they all together and bound themselves by mutual imprecations upon it. And they were in all 200 who descended in the days of Jared on the summit of Mount Hermon. And they called it Mount Hermon because they had sworn and bound themselves by mutual imprecations upon it. And these are the names of their leaders: Samlasaz, their leader; Arakalba, Ramael, Kokablel, Tamlel, Ramlel, Danel, Ezekiel, Barakihal, Asael, Armaros, Batarel, Ananel, Zakiel, Samaspiel, Satarel, Turel, Jomjael, Sariel. These are their chiefs of tens. Chapter 7. And all the others together with them took unto themselves wives, and each chose for himself one, and they began to go in unto them and to defile themselves with them. And they taught them charms and enchantments and the cutting of roots, and made them acquainted with plants. And they became pregnant, and they bare great giants whose height was 3,000 ells. Okay, and there's lots of controversy about that, and I don't know exactly what an L is, what the measurement of an L is. It's spelled ELLS. There are some people that have essayed to state that this is impossible and that Enoch was lying, or that this book is a fable. But this book is not a fable, and I don't know how tall 3,000 ells is, but what I know is that these giants were tall, and that the people of Israel said that they appeared as grasshoppers in their own sight compared to those people. Now, a grasshopper, if you're a man that's 6 feet tall and there's a grasshopper, how tall is it? Maybe about an inch tall, maybe less. Okay? So if you compare that grasshopper to you being 6 feet tall, and then pretend that you're that grasshopper, and there's another being that you're standing next to, which is as much taller than you as you are than that grasshopper, that's pretty large. Okay? That's pretty large. And so I don't know how tall 3,000 ells is, and I don't really care. It doesn't really matter. I just know that these creatures were huge. And it says, who consumed all the acquisitions of men. Okay, they ate all the farmland, all the produce that men were growing on the earth. These giants just began to devour up everything. And when men could no longer sustain them, the giants turned against them and devoured mankind. And they began to sin against birds and beasts and reptiles and fish, and to devour one another's flesh and drink the blood. Then the earth laid accusation against the lawless ones. Okay. Where did the Canaanites learn to drink blood? They learned it from the same place that women learned witchcrafts and men learned sorceries and how to cut roots and make drugs and how to, you know, and metallurgy, how to take metals out of the earth and make swords and breastplates and things like that. How women learned to paint their eyelids and paint their faces and decorate their bodies with various things. These things were all learned by the fallen angels. And the fallen angels came in unto the daughters of men, and the daughters of men bore children unto them, and the same were giants. Now let's go back to the Genesis chapter 6. In verse 4, it says, there were giants in the earth in those days. Okay? And also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. Why does the Bible say this? Because that's what it is. That's the case. Mighty men which were of old, men of renown. This is where the gods came from. Okay? These giants that were in the earth became known to people as the gods, and the people would sacrifice the people from their tribes unto them to keep them satisfied so that they wouldn't slaughter their whole tribe. That's when you hear about the legends of the gods and how that, you know, people used to take a virgin of their people and, you know, a little girl virgin and tie her up and throw her into a volcano to appease the gods. Well, the gods that they're referring to are these wicked giants who came from the fallen angels, and also the fallen angels themselves, who desired to be worshipped as gods. But then something happened. The flood came in the days of Noah. God called Noah and told him to build an ark for the saving of his house. And he did so. And the only people that were in the ark were Noah and his wife, and his three sons and their three wives. Eight people were the only people that were in the ark, because God saw Noah that he was just and faithful and righteous in his generations. And so God saved Noah and his family, and all the rest of the world perished. Okay? Noah was a preacher of righteousness, the scripture says, but nobody listened to him. And on the day that God shut the ark and the waters began to come from above and from beneath, then all of a sudden people got real serious, and they started to complain to Noah that he would let them in, and Noah had to tell them, I didn't shut the door, so I can't open it. I preached to you all for 120 years, and you all said that there is no God and that God doesn't exist and that I was a fool for building an ark in the middle of the desert. And now that which I've preached to you has come to pass, and I can't open the door because it is the Lord who shut the door. And now your reward shall be as you deserve. And so they all perished, and also the giants perished. Now when the giants perished, something happened, and I want to share that with you. It's in the book of Enoch, and it's in chapter 15. And I'm going to start with verse 8. It says, and now the giants who are produced from the spirits and flesh shall be called evil spirits upon the earth. And on the earth shall be their dwelling. Evil spirits have proceeded from their bodies, because they are born from men, and from the holy watchers is their beginning and primal origin. They shall be evil spirits on earth, and evil spirits shall they be called. Okay, evil spirits. This is also what is called in the scripture devils, or unclean spirits. These are the spirits of the giants. Okay, the giants that were born from angels and the daughters of men. The illicit union of angels and women, human women. These were the giants, and when the flood came and they were destroyed, their spirits remained on the earth, and they were called evil spirits. And these are the ones that Jesus and his people cast out of people. They're called devils, or unclean spirits. It says, as for the spirits of heaven, in heaven shall be their dwelling, but as for the spirits of the earth, which were born upon the earth, on the earth shall be their dwelling. And the spirits of the giants afflict, oppress, destroy, attack, do battle, and work destruction on the earth, and cause trouble. They take no food, but nevertheless hunger and thirst, and cause offenses. And these spirits shall rise up against the children of men, and against the women, because they have proceeded from them. So this is what unclean spirits are. Okay, and this is why Jesus said, in my name shall they cast out devils. This is who these spirits are. And you can see by who these spirits are and by the way that they act, what they were like, or what they must have been like when they were still in their bodies, living as giants upon the face of the earth. And you can see why people worshiped them as gods, because the people feared them. And so now, generation after generation after generation, all the cultures of the world have their tales or their myths about their gods. But the gods didn't just come from the imagination of some guy sitting around a campfire who drank too much coffee and said, "Hey, you know what we need? We need some gods." No, this story wasn't made up. All these stories weren't made up. These stories are come from that which was actually happening. Now, there may have been things embellished along the way, of course, but these all are based on a true story. Okay, they're based on the giants, the fallen ones. But now, as I began to say a little while ago, the flood came and destroyed the giants. So their spirits roamed the earth, continued to roam the earth after that, and still do to this day. And so now you know who unclean spirits are, what they are, and where they came from. But the giants themselves, the physical bodies of them, perished in the flood. But then we read about giants after the flood in the Bible, which is something very interesting. So I'm on Bible Gateway, and I just put in the search word giants, and I came up with 19 verses of the scripture that has the word giants, and I'm going to share them all with you. Okay, Genesis 6:4 that we just read. There were giants in the earth in those days. And also, after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. Okay, this is the gods. Numbers chapter 13, verse 33. This is when the children of Israel were sent. They were rescued out of Egypt, and they were sent into the promised land. And they sent the spies, and it says, "And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak." Now, this is happening after the flood, okay? Because the flood happened in Genesis chapter 9. We read about it rather in Genesis chapters 7 through 9. And so, this is in Numbers, after, Abraham, which was the 10th generation after Noah. And then Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac begat Israel, and Israel went down into Egypt, and they were there for 400 years. And then Moses came along, and God brought them up out of Egypt into the wilderness, and he brought them to the promised land, and they sent spies into the promised land. So that's where we're at right now in Numbers chapter 13. And it says, pardon me, "And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. So were we in their sight." Okay, I'm just going to pull out my little calculator here, and I'm going to see if a grasshopper is an inch tall, okay, and you are 6 feet tall. Say you're a man, you're 6 feet tall. Okay, so 6 feet, 6 times 12 is, no, not 412, Clinton. You can do better than that. I'm typing sideways, that's why. 6 times 12 is, of course, 70, I believe. Okay, my calculator's not working, but I think 6 times 12 is 70. Okay, let's do this right. Okay, no, 72. I'm sorry, 72. Yeah, it's a wonder that I passed math class. But anyway, so 6 times 12 is 72. So if you're 6 feet tall, you're 72 times higher than a grasshopper. So if you were that grasshopper and you are 6 feet tall, okay, then let's do 6 times 72. That's 432 feet. 432 feet. Okay, that's 43 stories. That's the same as a building that is 43 stories tall. So that's pretty big. Okay, and I can't say for sure. Don't tell anybody that Brother Clinton said the Giants were 432 feet tall, because I'm just guessing, because of the approximate size of a grasshopper compared to the approximate size of a man. But this is what the Bible says, okay? And there were other giants that were not quite that big, like Goliath and, his father and his other brothers and stuff, but and also Og, the king of Bashan. But these particular giants, the Bible says, "There we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight." Okay? Now, why would we think that the people were lying if they weren't? I mean, why would we think that the Bible was telling us a lie? If the giants weren't really that big, then why wouldn't it have said we were like, pigs in their sight, or we were like, calves in their sight, we were like a lamb in their sight, or something like that? Why didn't they say that? Why didn't they say we were like a raccoon in their sight? Why did they say grasshoppers? Because that's what they were talking about, obviously. And we just tend to read by this and say, "Oh, they were big people," and then we just keep reading on. But wait a second. Wait a second. a grasshopper? We were like grasshoppers in our own sight compared to them? Really? Let's take a minute to think about that. You're a grown man and you see a grasshopper. It's about the size of your little toe. Okay? So this is how the people of Israel saw the Anakim, the sons of Anak. And they were as grasshoppers in their own sight compared to these giants. And this happened after the flood. Deuteronomy chapter 2, verse 11, which were also accounted giants as the Anakims, but the Moabites called them Emims. Okay? The Moabites had a name for these giants. They called them Emims. All the Moabites knew about these giants. They had a name for them. And then Deuteronomy 2:20, that was also accounted a land of giants. Giants dwelt there in old time, and the Ammonites called them Zamzummims. So the Ammonites also had a name for these giants. All the Ammonites, all the people of Ammon, knew, all the people of Moab and Ammon, which were the two sons of Lot, okay, and their tribes, they all knew about these giants, and they had names for them. Okay? They called them Emims and Zamzummims. Okay? They had names for them. They knew about them. This isn't a myth. This is reality. Okay? Almost that whole land of Canaan was filled with giants. It says in Deuteronomy chapter 3, verse 11, for only Og, king of Bashan, remained of the remnant of giants. Behold, his bedstead was a bedstead of iron. Is it not in Rabbath of the children of Ammon? 9 cubits was the length thereof, and 4 cubits the breadth of it after the cubit of a man. Okay, a cubit of a man is from the tip of your fingers to your elbow, which is approximately 18 inches, a foot and a half. So 9 cubits is 13 and a half feet. That's how long his bed was, 13 and a half feet. Okay, now this guy wasn't at all as big as the Anakim, but he was still of the sons of the giants, and he was a huge person. Okay, Deuteronomy 3:13, and the rest of Gilead and all Bashan, pardon me, being the kingdom of Og, gave I unto the half tribe of Manasseh, and all the region of Argob with all Bashan, which was called the land of giants. Which was called the land of giants. Deuteronomy 3:13. There was an entire land that was called the land of giants. And the coast of Og, Joshua 12:4, and the coast of Og, king of Bashan, which was of the remnant of the giants that dwelt at Ashtaroth at Edrei. Joshua 13:12, and all the kingdom of Og and Bashan, which reigned in Ashtaroth and in Edrei, who remained of the remnant of the giants, for these did Moses smite and cast them out. Joshua 15:8, and the border went up by the valley of the son of Hinnom unto the south side of the Jebusite, the same as Jerusalem, and the border went up to the top of the mountain that lieth before the valley of Hinnom eastward, which is at the end of the valley of the giants northward. So the place where Jerusalem is used to be the Valley of Giants. It was a complete nation of giants, huge oversized humanoids. Joshua 17:15, and Joshua answered them, if thou be a great people, then get thee up to the wood country and cut down for thyself there in the land of the Perizzites and of the giants, if Mount Ephraim be too narrow for thee. Joshua 18:16, and the border came down to the end of the mountain that lieth before the valley of the son of Hinnom, and which is in the valley of the giants on the north. Okay? Now, 2 Samuel chapter 21. We wonder sometimes why David, the son of Jesse, when he was going after Goliath, went to the river, and he went to the river. I don't know if he went to the river or not, but he bent down and he took five smooth stones out of the brook. Okay? And he put them in his scrip, and then he went to the giant and he slung one of the stones at the giant. Why did he have five? Well, because Goliath was one of five sons. Okay, for some reason, either David knew this, or he just picked up five stones by revelation, and it was caused to be written in the scripture that way, because God knew that Goliath had four brothers, and they were all the sons of the giant of Gath. So in 2 Samuel 21:16, it says. And well, let's just go to I have it open in another page here in 2 Samuel 21. So I'm going to start at verse 16. It says, "And Ishbi-Benob, which was of the sons of the giant, the weight of whose spear weighed 300 shekels of brass in weight, he being girded with a new sword, thought to have slain David. But Abishai the son of Zeruiah succored him and smote the Philistine and killed him. Then the men of David swear unto him, saying, Thou shalt go no more out with us to battle, that thou quench not the light of Israel. And it came to pass after this that there was again a battle with the Philistines at Gob. Then Sibekai the Hushathite slew Saph, which was of the sons of the giant. And there was again a battle in Gob with the Philistines, where Elhanan the son of Jeari-Oregim, pardon me for not pronouncing his name correctly, a Bethlehemite, slew the brother of Goliath the Gittite, the staff of whose spear was like a weaver's beam. And there was yet a battle in Gath, where was a man of great stature, that had on every hand 6 fingers and on every foot 6 toes, 24 in number, and he also was born to the giant. And when he defied Israel, Jonathan the son of Shimeah, the brother of David, slew him. These 4 were born to the giant in Gath, and fell by the hand of David and by the hand of his servants. So that's why David picked up 5 smooth stones out of the brook. In 1 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 4, it says, And it came to pass after this that there arose war at Gezer with the Philistines, at which time Sibekai the Hushathite slew Sipai, that was of the children of the giant. I believe he's the one that was called Saph in 2 Samuel. And they were subdued. And in 1 Chronicles 20, verse 6, and also 1 Chronicles 20, verse 8, it tells the same story that we just read in 2 Samuel chapter 21. Okay, so this is, and of course the last mention of the word giant is in Job 16:14. It says, He breaketh me with breach upon breach, he runneth upon me like a giant. That's not really talking about giant men, but this being the case, there's 19 times when the word giant or giants is mentioned in the scripture, and except for the last one that we read in Job, they're all referring to humanoids, to men that were born of women but were extraordinarily huge, and it's because that their fathers were not human, their fathers were angels. Okay, now I want to share with you something in the Revelation. We've been in the Genesis, let's go to the Revelation chapter 12. Hallelujah, blessed be the reading of the Word of God. Because there are some of you that might be saying, well, how do we know that after the flood these giants came from angels? And so that's why I want to take you to the Revelation chapter 12. Now, for those of you who would like to have more understanding or information about the Revelation, there is an entire playlist on this channel called The Revelation Verse by Verse. And I've gone through the entire book of the Revelation for you and expounded upon it verse by verse, and it's divided into chapters. So if you want to know more about what's written in chapter 12 or the other chapters that we're going to go into right now, I highly suggest that you go to the playlist called The Revelation Verse by Verse and just go through the whole book of the Revelation with me. It was such a blessing to do that. It took me a couple of years to do it. Of course, I did it, you know, off and on as I had the time to do it. It took me a couple of years to finish it, and it was such a blessing going through the book of the Revelation with you all. And the reason that I did that was it was by revelation from God, of course, and it was because of a desire that I had in my heart to share the book of the Revelation. And I kept waiting for the time when God would give me some disciples of like precious faith, where I could be in a group of disciples and teaching them when they were ready to receive those things. And that just hadn't happened at that time. And so I said, Lord, I have the need to share this. And so he gave me the permission to go ahead and share it on YouTube. And so in that way, you know, it's been out there for everybody to watch, but it's also been out there for those who truly love the Lord and are ready to receive the things of the book of the Revelation. And that was the answer to my prayer. Praise the Lord. So I hope that'll be a blessing to you, and I hope you'll check that out and share it with others as well. Having said that, let's open up to the book of the Revelation in chapter 12. It says, And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth, and pained to be delivered. Okay, this woman is Israel, and this is made known unto us by Joseph's dream in Genesis chapter 37. Okay, the woman is not Mary, and the image that Catholic people have of a woman with the moon under her feet and the stars over her head is not Mary, and doesn't have anything to do with this vision that John saw. Okay, the woman that Catholics have in their image, her name is Semiramis. She's also been called Isis. She's also been called Diana. She's also been called the Queen of Heaven. She is a devil. And she was worshipped by the people of Israel in the days of Jeremiah as the Queen of Heaven. And she's still worshipped by pagans as the Queen of Heaven. And God told the people of Israel not to worship her by the mouth of Jeremiah, but they wouldn't listen. And so they wound up going into captivity. And unfortunately, millions of people, in fact, over 1 billion people, as far as I know, on the earth today, worship that satanic entity that they call the Virgin. And it's far from a virgin at all. It is the most unclean entity that there could possibly be. And that's what they're worshiping. And that has nothing to do with this vision that John saw here. But I digress because that's not what I wanted to talk to you about. Let's move on in verse 3. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. Now, I asked in your stead just a couple of minutes ago, well, how do we know that the giants after the flood came from fallen angels? Because the scripture doesn't tell us that at that time. Well, this is how we know this right here, and I'm going to explain to you why. Praise the Lord. Pardon me just for a moment again. So, if we start again in verse 3, it says, "And there appeared another wonder in heaven." Okay? Jesus is showing John these things. He showed John the vision of the woman being travailing in birth and pain to be delivered. And then he showed John this other entity. And behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. If we know the scripture, this reveals to us many things. First of all, the great red dragon is, of course, the devil. Because if we go down to verse 9, it says, "And that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world." And also in the 20th chapter, it gives this same identification of him. Chapter 20, verse 2, it says, "And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years." So we know who the dragon is. There can be no question about who the dragon it is. It is the devil. It is Satan. It is the serpent. Okay? These are all words that refer to the same entity. So it says, "And behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns." Okay? Now, there's many times that we read about this beast having 7 heads and 10 horns. For instance, in the 13th chapter, in verse 1, "And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy." Okay? And again, in chapter 17, and what verse is it in? Pardon me just for a moment. It's in verse 3. "So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. Okay? So this beast, who is the dragon and the serpent and the devil, has 7 heads and 10 horns. Okay? And this is not what the devil looks like. This is a vision that God showed John, which was representative of that entity. The 7 heads represent something. The 10 horns represent something. And the fact that we read sometimes that the crowns were upon the heads, the 7 heads, means something. And at other times we read that the crowns were upon the 10 horns, that means something also. So let me just take a few minutes to explain that to you. If we go back to chapter 17, it says, "So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth." Okay, this is, of course, the religion that has been known for the last 1700 years as the Roman Catholic Church, and all of her Protestant daughters. Okay? All Protestant churches are part of the Roman Catholic Church. They're part of this beast. They are the harlots, and she is the mother of harlots. And this system existed way before the Roman Catholic Church existed. The Roman Catholic Church is merely the mask that she put on about 1700 years ago. She has existed long before then. She is the mystery of Babylon. She is the religion of Babylon, which is also the religion of Rome, which is why the Roman Catholic Church is called the Roman Catholic Church. And all of her Protestant daughters are worshiping Rome right along with her and keeping the practices and the pagan traditions of Rome. And so it says, "And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, Wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carrieth her, which hath the 7 heads and 10 horns. The beast that thou sawest," pay attention, please, because this is you're going to need to understand the details of this. "The beast that thou sawest," okay, the beast is not the woman. The beast is what is underneath the woman. The woman was riding the beast. Okay, the woman is the political and ecclesiastical system of Rome and the Vatican. Okay, and the beast is the political system that she rides upon. Rather, pardon me, I should correct myself. The woman is the ecclesiastical system, and the beast is the political system that she rides upon. Okay, the religious system of this world under Satan has always had control over the political system. This is manifest in the fact that the Pharisees, after the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, they told the soldiers, which were supposed to be guarding the tomb, to take this money and tell your superiors that his disciples came and by night while you were asleep and stole his body. Now, if the soldiers would have told their superiors that, they would have killed them. Okay, but the Pharisees persuaded these soldiers to take the money, saying that if there's any problem, we will persuade them. These soldiers knew that the Pharisees, the religious leaders, could persuade their higher officers to not kill them. They knew that, otherwise they wouldn't have taken the money, because why would they take the money for if they were about to die? What good will their money do them in the grave? But they knew that the religious leaders had power over their military leaders. And so they took the money and did as they were told. And it's still the same today. All the people, all the political leaders of this world take their orders from Rome, from the Vatican. That's a fact. So, the beast that thou sawest was and is not... Pardon me, where was I? Let's go back to verse 7. "And the angel said unto me, Wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carrieth her, which hath the 7 heads and 10 horns. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit." Okay. The beast, this is, in this particular case, the beast is representative of a man that is the leader of that system, that Antichrist system. Okay. "The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit." Okay, and without going into a lot of detail, by this we know, having searched the scriptures, that the man that is called Antichrist, Lucifer, the son of perdition, is one who will either be risen from the dead or appear to be risen from the dead. Because, of course, the Lord Jesus Christ is risen from the dead, so it stands to reason that the Antichrist will also present himself as being risen from the dead. And this is why The scripture says in a different place that one of the heads of the beast had a wound from a sword, but did live. So it says, "The beast that thou sawest was and is not." Okay, so it's somebody who had previously died in the first century when Jesus Christ was giving this to John. And is not. He was and is not. "And shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is." This is talking about Lucifer, the man of sin, the Antichrist, the false Messiah, the one that will rise up from the tribes of Israel in the future from now and call himself by his own name, and the people of Israel will receive him. This is why Jesus said, "I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him you will receive." The Jews are going to build their temple. They're going to start doing sacrifices when God enables them to do so by giving them the things that they need to reinstitute temple sacrifice. And because they reject their Messiah, God is going to give them over to a false Messiah. And that's who this is talking about. Verse 9, "And here is the mind which hath wisdom. The 7 heads are 7 mountains on which the woman sitteth." Okay. Now, I can't say this authoritatively like I've gotten it from God, but I do know that it is a fact that Rome is known as the city on seven hills. But then again, so is Jerusalem. So I don't know which this is referring to, but then again, Jerusalem is also referred to as Egypt and Sodom in the scripture. So having said that, verse 10, and there are seven kings. Okay, these are representative of the seven heads of the beast. Five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come. Okay, now so during the time that Jesus was speaking this to John, about 2,000 years ago, 1,900 something years ago, this was true at that time. Five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come. I don't know who that one is, but it was a king that was reigning at that time when John wrote this. I don't know if it's talking about the Roman emperor or who it's talking about. I don't know. I wish I did, but I don't. But this is what I do know. And there are seven kings. Five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition. And the ten horns which thou sawest are ten kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Okay, this is talking about something in the future from now. It says, these have one mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. And how do I know this is in the future from now? Well, if we study the book of Daniel, we can see in chapters 7 and 8 that it's obviously in the future from now. And there's other parts of the revelation in this particular prophecy that make that manifest as well. So, verse 13. These have one mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. This is how we know that it's talking about in the future from now also. For he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. And he saith unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the whore sitteth, are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. And the ten horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. For God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will, and to agree, and to give their kingdom unto the beast, until the words of God shall be fulfilled. These are the ten toes that Nebuchadnezzar saw in his image, in his dream. And Daniel interpreted the dream in the second chapter of Daniel. And these are ten kingdoms that will arise in the last days. Now, there are people about maybe 20 years ago who thought that they were the 10 different states of Europe, I guess. And even if maybe there were 10, maybe there weren't. I guess there were more after that. But when Europe divided up in the European Union, and they divided up into states, I think they're called the Schengen states, there were many Bible prophecy teachers that were teaching people that these were the 10 kingdoms. Well, that didn't make sense to me then, even. But there's many people that are always trying to smash things into prophecy, like someone would take the wrong piece of a puzzle and try to smash it into the puzzle and make it fit. But really, you know, if it's really the piece of the puzzle, then you don't have to smash it in to make it fit. It'll just fit perfectly, and the people of God will know when these things happen. And as I've said before, this is why prophecy is given to us in the scripture, not so that we can know beforehand what's going to happen and when it's going to happen, but so that when it happens, we will know that it's that thing that's happening, and we will know at that time what to do and where to go. Praise the Lord. So, verse 17, for God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will, and to agree, and to give their kingdom unto the beast, until the words of God shall be fulfilled. So these are ten kingdoms. These ten horns on the beast are ten kingdoms. They're representative of ten kingdoms which shall arise in the future from now. And they shall arise out of that fourth beast, which is what we read in the seventh chapter of Daniel, in the vision of the four beasts that he saw rising up out of the sea. And the fourth beast, out of the fourth beast, there arose ten horns. And there arose another little horn among them, which overthrew three of the horns. And that little horn, of course, is the Antichrist. And so, the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth, which is, of course, Rome, Vatican City. And so when I say Rome and Vatican City, they're not the same thing, but one is contained by the other. So we can see from Revelation chapter 17 that there's a reason that this beast was presented to John as having seven heads and ten horns. The seven heads represent seven kings, five of whom were fallen in the day that John received this prophecy. One was, and the other was yet to come. And the 10 horns are representative of 10 other kings which shall come in the future from now, in the last days, okay, or at the last time, shortly before the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's important for us to understand, because in, let's see, in Revelation chapter 13, verse 1, it says, "And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy." So we see that in chapter 13, the things that John was seeing and writing about, were that vision was pertaining to a time in the future from now, or right about now, because the 10 horns were crowned. You see, the crowns were on the 10 horns, which means that this is talking about the time when those 10 kingdoms will arise and shall be reigning and shall give their strength and power unto the beast. But here in chapter 12, when it says in verse 3, "And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his heads." So we know, and I said all that to say this, remember when we were in chapter 12 about a long time ago, and then we went into chapter 13 and over into chapter 17 and all that? I went into all that to show you this, that there's a reason that the scripture says that the 7 crowns were upon his heads. That tells us what period of time in history this is talking about. Okay, it's talking about a time in the past. And also, the second half of verse 4 lets us know that this is talking about a time in the past before Messiah was born. Okay, so now let's read it again, starting with verse 3. "And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And if we go on, we can see, and she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up unto God unto his throne." So we know that that's Messiah, our Lord Jesus Christ. And from verse 5 into verse 6 is a complete different shift in time, because verse 6 begins talking about something that's in the future from now, that will happen during the Great Tribulation. But up until verse 5, from verse 3 to verse 5, the scripture is talking about things that happened before our Messiah was born 2,000 years ago. Okay? And the thing that I want to point out to you in verses 3 through 5, which is obviously talking about things that happened before our Messiah was born 2,000 years ago, the beginning of verse 4 says, "And his tail, the serpent's tail, the dragon, the great red dragon, his tail drew the third part," pardon me, "of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth." Okay, obviously the stars of heaven in this vision is representative of angels. Okay, and I could take you all through the scripture and show you examples of that, but I'm sure that you understand that. If you don't, just do a search for it, and you know, go to Bible Gateway and you know, and put in the search bar "stars of heaven," and there's many times when the scripture describes the stars of heaven as angels, or the angels as the stars of heaven. You know, especially in Job, I'm thinking about when all the morning stars shouted for joy. And so the scripture says, "And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth," in this vision that John saw. Okay, this the tail of the great red dragon did not literally draw the third part of the stars of heaven, which would be millions and billions of burning balls of gas, and cast them to the earth. That's not what this is talking about. It's a vision, and it's representative of something, and it's representative of angels. Okay, a third part of the host of the angels have been drawn into the earth. Those original 200 that descended on Mount Hermon were but a fraction, a tiny fraction, of the angels that have rebelled against the living God, which is why God has charged his angels with folly. It's written in the book of Job again. And they have come down to the earth, and they have disguised themselves as men, and they have infiltrated the human race. And there are giants in the earth. Now, you might say, Brother Clinton, how can this be? How can an angel beget children? Okay, well, I have two answers for that, okay, or two parts to that answer. First of all, we know that it happened because the Bible says it happened. So whether or not we understand how it happened is irrelevant because we know that it happened. Okay, we know that God created the heavens and the earth. If we can't figure out how God created the heavens and the earth, that doesn't mean that we should discredit it just because we as humans can't figure it out. And that we should say that God was lying and he didn't really create the heavens and the earth just because we can't figure out how he did that. Okay? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's what the Bible says, and that's what happened. Okay? And we know how he did it. He did it by his word. So we know also that angels, the sons of God, came in unto the daughters of men, and they bore children unto them, and they became giants, and those giants were the mighty men of renown. Okay, mighty men of old, men of renown. And these are those that were called the gods. And when those that were before the flood, their sons died before the flood, those sons of the angels, those giants, they perished, but their spirits were left on the earth to roam around as unclean spirits. Those are devils, okay? And after that, after the flood, there were more giants in the earth. In fact, there were entire nations of them, and the scripture makes this clear. And not only does the scripture make this clear, but if you have to search hard for it, but there were lots and lots and lots of news articles up until about 1900 or the middle 1800s where people posted articles and pictures of giant skeletons, giant human skeletons, in various parts of the earth, on various continents of the earth. Except for now, these days, the globalist mafia has risen up with evil organizations like the Smithsonian Institute and National Geographic and things like that to entertain us with, you know, lions and lions feeding their cubs and cheetahs killing, you know, wildebeests and stuff like that, and to hide from us the reality of the fact that there are giants in the earth, and there have been giants in the earth ever since the beginning. And so the Smithsonian was created for the purpose of hiding away archaeological finds that would cause people to realize that the Bible is the truth, and to put in as a front, you know, other things that they have supposedly discovered, and even other things that are complete lies, like the dinosaur myth, the dinosaur fable. And for those of you who don't know, there was never any such thing as dinosaurs on the earth. That's all a fable, and it was given to us by Jesuit archaeologists. So, but I digress. That's not the point. The point is that Satan has taken a third of the angels of heaven and drawn them into the earth. And they have been walking among us. They are among us. Okay? Some people have called them serpent-like people. Or, you know, I forget the term, but, you know, reptilians. Okay? And these are people that don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. And so they've seen into this world. They've seen things that have been revealed either by accident or on purpose. And all they can see is these people are reptilians. Well, what they don't understand is that these people or these beings are either or both fallen angels or the sons thereof. There is also a subterranean world, okay, and I can't prove that, and I'm not willing to argue with anybody about it. If you don't believe that, that's between you and God, and I'm not going to argue with you about it. But there was a man whose name was Byrd, who was a Navy admiral, who several decades ago was flying in his airplane, and he flew into the, I believe it was the North Pole. It was either the North or the South Pole, but I believe it was the North Pole. And he saw, as he was flying over it, a giant hole. And that's why Google Earth won't show you the top of the Earth and the bottom of the Earth. Either one of the poles, they won't show you. All it shows you is just it's covered with ice, supposedly. But he flew into that hole, and he saw a civilization. He saw land and water and people and civilization. And it is known to us by just, you know, a regular search on YouTube that there are military installations called DUMBs, D-U-M-B, Deep Underground Military Bases. And they're built, and there's an entire network underground, high-speed trains that connect them back and forth, which is why all these loud booms are being heard all over the place. And you hear on these, you know, local news channels that it's just a mystery and the police know nothing about it and the military say they don't know anything about it. Well, the higher-ups in the military know what it is. It's construction going on down beneath in military underground bases. And so there is an entire civilization underground, and there are recorded events of men fighting with humanoid creatures under the earth that are not like you and me. Okay, there is another race on this earth among us. And the Bible says in Hebrews, just come with me over to Hebrews chapter 13 real quick. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 1, it says, "Let brotherly love continue," and then verse 2, pardon me, "be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares." Now let's talk about this for a moment. The writer of Hebrews, okay, some say it was Paul, some say it was Barnabas, it doesn't really matter, it was written by inspiration of the Holy Ghost. But he said, "Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares." This person, this apostle or disciple or elder in Jesus Christ, is telling us that we should not be forgetful to entertain strangers, because it's possible that when a stranger comes to you and is hungry or needy or needs help, that it's actually an angel. But if it's an angel, how is it an angel if it's able to appear as a man, if you're able to touch it, shake hands with it, feed it, and it could eat with you? Okay, when God appeared to Abraham with two angels in Genesis chapter 18, the Bible says that three men appeared to Abraham, but it's evident from the scripture that those three men were God and two angels. Because God spoke with Abraham, and then the angels turned from him and went to Sodom in the 19th chapter, in the very next chapter. And when the two angels went to Sodom, then the men of the city thought that they were men also. And the Bible speaks of them as being men who came to Lot's house. Okay, but they weren't men, they were angels, but they appeared as men. They appeared in the form of men. And this is why the Native Americans will tell you, and they will swear up and down, that they've seen shape changers. And they're used to people saying that they're crazy for saying that. But they're not crazy for saying it. It's reality. Angels are able to change their visage. They're able to change their form. They're able to change from spirit into flesh. They're able to change from the appearance of a deer to the appearance of a lion to the appearance of a man. Angels are able to do that. Okay? I mean, just look at the living creatures that were round about the throne, and the living creatures that Ezekiel wrote about and that John wrote about. Okay? That's not just stuff we read like some religious myth. That's reality. These brothers, Ezekiel and John, wrote down what they saw. They were there. They saw these angels. See, angels are greater in power and might than we, and they're able to change their visage, their form. They're able to change into the form of a human. And an angel can change himself into the form of a human and walk up to you and give you a hug, shake your hand. He could be injured. You could be helping him by binding up a wound or carrying him to your house or giving him food, and he could eat with you. You know, all these things have happened with angels. The Almighty God appeared as a man to Israel, to Jacob, and he wrestled with him all night long. Now, how does a man wrestle with God? God appeared as a man. Jacob wasn't wrestling with a phantasm. He wasn't wrestling with a ghost. He was wrestling with a man. A man. He was grappling with him. He put his hands on just about every part of his body and was wrestling with him, trying to wrestle him down to the ground. That's not a myth. It's history. It happened. And so God put his seed in the womb of a virgin of his own people, Israel, and begat a son. So why do we think that angels can't put their seed into the wombs of women, even by a way that is not holy, by fornication? The Bible says that their issue is as the issue of horses in Ezekiel chapter 23. And so angels, fallen angels, okay, fallen means that they have left their first estate. They came down onto Mount Hermon and took to themselves wives of all which they chose, and they begat sons, and those sons were giants, and they became mighty men of old, men of renown. And then when the flood came, those giants perished, and their spirits continue to wander around throughout the earth, and they are called unclean spirits or devils. And after that time, after the flood, many more angels rebelled against God and came down into the earth and fornicated with women and engendered sons, okay, or sons and daughters. I don't know if it's daughters as well, but they engendered sons. And those sons became the giants, the land of the giants, who Israel saw, and they were like grasshoppers before them. And even Enoch, in the days of Enoch, he said that they were 3,000 ells, whatever an ell is, I don't know. But these were incredibly huge beings. Like we said, if the people of Israel really were as the same, you know, in the same proportion as a grasshopper is to a man in front of these people, then that means, according to my calculations on the calculator, that they were like 45 stories tall. Now, is that a tall tale? No, it's the word of God. It happened. It happened. And there are, I mean, you can still find today images on the internet of skeletons of giants that have been found. You have to look around for it and you have to dig for it, but they're there. Giants are reality. They were in the earth in the days of Enoch. They were in the earth in the days of Noah. In the days when Nimrod sat on his throne and Abraham was alive in those days and the people were worshiping the gods of Nimrod, those gods were the fallen angels and their sons. And the people so feared them that they began to worship them and sacrifice their children unto them. And this was the practice of the Canaanites, which is why God said to his people Israel, when you go into that land, I don't want you to learn the way of the heathen. I don't want you to figure out and ask these people how they serve their gods so that you can do as they did. I want you to serve me. I want you to be a holy people unto me. I'm going to tell you things that are clean and unclean to eat. I'm going to tell you things that I want you to do and not to do. I want to tell you sexual practices that I want you to do and not do. Okay, and that's what the whole 17th or 18th chapter of Leviticus is all about, because the people in Canaan were, after the worshiping of their gods, their devil gods, they were fornicating with one another, with their fathers and mothers and sisters and brothers and animals and all sorts of ungodly things. And God told his people Israel, when you go into that land, don't learn the things that they do. And the reason that he said that was because those people were serving the devil gods, which are actually the fallen angels and their offspring. Because the fallen angels came into the world both before and after the flood and begat sons by the daughters of men. And there are entire subterranean civilizations under the earth, okay, the land that you're living on right now, under the earth, between you and hell, there is an expanse, and there are nations, civilizations, under there. And in that place, there are giants. There are also giants which either are or have ascended to certain areas of this earth, and you can find stories of people having killed them as well. I mean, there's a famous story going around the internet of some U.S. military that killed one in Afghanistan not too long ago. And so there are giants in the earth, and they are the gods. They are the gods. They are the ones that the people in their various cultures and nations have their traditions and they worship as gods. And we've all been taught in school that all these were just myths. And, you know, the pyramids, which still are all over the world on every continent today, we're all told in school that they're just myths. They're just, you know, one of the great wonders of the world. They're there, right there, made out of stone, but nobody seems to know how they got there. Well, it's obvious how they got there. They were built by giants. And they were built not only by giants, people who were of great stature and many times larger than a normal human being, but also many times wiser and more creative, more ingenious than a human being. And most people don't know that there was electric lighting and batteries in the land of Egypt when Moses and Israel were in the land of Egypt and in Babylon. And most people, and I don't know that this is true and I can't prove it, but I believe that there was also intergalactic travel in the days of Enoch, when Enoch walked upon the face of the earth. And it's very possible that pyramids were built for that purpose, for either time travel or intergalactic travel. They weren't just tombs. They're built in specific places at specific angles in specific shape, in that specific shape, for specific reasons. Okay? And those that are the higher up in the occults, they know why, you know, who built the pyramids and why they're there and what they're used for. But they don't tell the plebs, you and me, what that's all about. They just say, well, it's just, you know, it's a mystery. You know, they just tell us, you know, nobody's ever figured out how they built them or what they were for. And we're in school and we just go, oh, okay, whatever, what's for lunch? But we never really stop to think about, you know, what a ridiculous lie that these pyramids have been there for thousands of years and yet everyone tells us nobody knows who built them. That's ridiculous. Somebody knows who built them. Okay, and the scripture makes absolutely clear who built them. They were giants. You know, they say, how could these people have moved these large stones across all these large expanses? I mean, maybe they put them on logs with thousands of slaves and stuff. That's garbage. We're talking about beings that are 43 stories tall, 45 stories tall, that can pick up a stone, a solid stone the size of most people's house, with their right hand and just put it on their shoulder and carry it, you know, and one stride for them is like maybe, you know, a block, two blocks, okay? That's how they got there. And they were built specifically for a purpose and specifically and exactly the way they are and where they are for a reason, because they all fall on the lines. What am I, the horrors, what am I thought, what am I thinking of? The lines that are all around the earth. I can't think of the lines right now. The geographical lines that are placed all around the earth with degrees. Latitude and longitude, that's what I'm thinking of. Latitudinal and longitudinal lines. They're all placed in a specific way, for a specific purpose, lined up with the stars. Okay, they weren't put there on accident, and they didn't happen to pop up all over the world along, you know, specifically along all these lines on accident. Okay, they were put there on purpose, and they were built by beings that were much larger than you and me. I mean, the evidence is all around us that giants are alive and on the earth. They have been for many generations, many centuries. And the scripture says in Daniel chapter 2, verse 43, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, speaking about the toes and the feet of the image that Nebuchadnezzar saw. So we know that the Bible says that the same type of union that occurred and that we read about in Genesis chapter 6, verse 4, is also going to be happening in the last days, right before the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, praise the Lord. I believe that I've covered everything that I needed to cover. There was a lot of information that I've covered in this video, and I've been speaking for almost an hour and a half. Praise the Lord. So, if any of you have any questions about something that I touched on that I didn't really cover, you're welcome to ask me, and if I know how to answer you, I certainly will. If I don't know how to answer you, I'm going to give you an honest, I don't know. Because I've learned that it's much better to say you don't know something than to pretend that you do and speak something that's too high for you. But the things that I've spoken to you in this video are just simple facts. They're not things that are hard to understand or hard to find out. I've read them to you from the Holy Scripture and from the Book of Enoch, and I've told you about things that you can find easily with a search on the internet. And the truth of the matter is that there are giants. They're the offspring of angels and human women, that they were here before the flood. They've been here after the flood, and they're still here today. They disguise themselves as men, and they are involved in higher levels of politics, entertainment, the judicial system, every strata of society, basically. That's why the Bible says that the devil is the god of this world in 2 Corinthians 4:4, and in Ephesians chapter 2 verse 2 that he is the prince of the power of the air. The devil is not to glorify him, because the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, but for a time Adam has given authority over to the devil for all the kingdoms of the earth, and the devil is the ruler of this world, and he controls everything basically through, as far as in a human sense, from his servant the Pope on the throne in the Vatican on down the line, to the Jesuits, to the colleges and universities, to the to the judicial system, to the political system, to the entertainment industry. All these things are controlled and operated by Satan, and many of the people that you think are human in those positions are actually not completely human. And they're appearing as human, even as the scripture makes perfectly clear that, you know, the scripture says, be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for some have entertained angels thereby unawares. So it's possible that, you know, a person, a human that you have met, sometime who needed something and you helped out that person. It's possible that that person was an angel. The Bible tells us that. It's possible that that person was an angel without telling you, just to test you and to see what you would do. God is able to do that, and he does that. And so if he can do that, then, you know, if angels can appear as men, and if, you know, like the Native Americans that I've spoken to or talk about these skinwalkers, that's the word I was looking for, not fleshwalkers, skinwalkers and shape changers. And there's all these, you know, I mentioned in the beginning of the video about, you know, werewolves and Bigfoot and the Loch Ness Monster, and how people, you know, love to watch videos and movies about stuff like that and imagine that it's all just a myth. Well, it's not a myth at all. The Loch Ness Monster is not a myth. It's people seeing dragons. Okay? And dragons don't like to be seen. So when somebody sees one, once it knows that it's being seen, it hides itself. Okay? Dragons are a reality. Dinosaurs are a myth and dragons are a reality. Isn't that something? Because we were taught the exact opposite all of our lives in school. We were always taught that dragons are a myth and that dinosaurs are reality, when in fact there's no tangible proof that any such thing as a dinosaur ever existed on the face of the earth. The only proof that they have of it is manufactured skeletons that they made in laboratories, partially from the bones of large animals and partially from bronze. And so, you know, that's, you know, the dinosaur myth is, it's just a lie. It's all a Jesuit created lie based on nothing. And it is there to take away the knowledge from us that dragons are real. Dragons are actual real animals. I mean, you can read about one in detail in the 41st chapter of Job. God describes it in detail from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. Okay, to his nails, his toenails, and his scales, and the fact that he breathes fire. Okay, dragons are a reality. And that's what people have seen when they've seen things like the Loch Ness Monster. And then that's what a lot of people are seeing in part when they see these so-called dinosaur skeletons in these paleontological exhibits. Okay, they're dragon skeletons that have been modified to look like some sort of dinosaur creature. And then they have all these fables about this particular dinosaur lived so many million years ago, and this one lived so many millions of years ago, and this is what they ate, and this is what they did, and it's all cartoons. And people just watch it and go, oh yeah, that's, and they just buy it. They just believe it. And they, for that reason, they believe that, you know, the Bible is a lie, because the Bible says that man has been on the earth for 6,000 years. But yet when they believe the dinosaur lie, they imagine that man has been on the earth for millions of years, and that dinosaurs were on the earth millions of years ago. And they believe that oil deposits come from dinosaur bones, which is ridiculous. And many more things like that. But the truth of the matter is that dragons are a reality. Okay? And that's what people are seeing when they've seen the Loch Ness Monster. And when people have seen things like werewolves and, you know, Bigfoot, what are they seeing? They're seeing giants. Okay? They're seeing creatures that are the offspring of angels and human women. And why is it that they always run away and try to hide? Well, because they don't want to be seen. And what's going on in Antarctica? Why are the leaders of this world, they're not really the leaders, but the puppet leaders, the ones that, you know, the real leaders allow us to see on the media, why are these people scheduling trips to Antarctica? What in the world are they doing in Antarctica? Presidents and vice presidents and the leaders of the, you know, the Eastern Orthodox Church and the Pope, the leader of the Roman Church, why are they going to Antarctica? What's going on down there that all these people need to know about, that all these people need to go down there for? Well, obviously, they're going down there to meet with their leaders. You see, the rulers of this world believe that they're in contact with extraterrestrials. And that's why they're doing the things that they're doing, because there is a force of extraterrestrials, which is actually fallen angels, who are more powerful than the leaders of this world, and the leaders of this world are afraid of them and can't do battle against them, so they are doing their will. And they're, because of their religion, because they're Satanists, they bow down and they worship these people. The Pope is a Satanist. All the presidents of the nations are Satanists. You can't get into an office of politics in this world unless you're in the club. And the club is the Skull and Bones. The club is the CFR. The club is the worshipers of Satan, the synagogue of Satan. They worship devils, and the devils that they worship meet with them in Antarctica when they go down there, and they instruct them and they give them the things that they have need of. They give them the technology that they have need of. The technology that you and I are familiar with right now is technology that the fallen angels gave to the globalists of this world 30 and 40 years ago. And now they're done with that and they've graduated onto other things, so they hand down their seconds down to us. Why? Because they love us? No, so they can track us and control us. You see? It's all going just as planned. It's all going exactly as the scripture said it would happen, all to fulfill the scripture. A one-world government, a one-world religion. And it's all happening under the governorship of Satan. And that's why the leaders of this world go down to Antarctica and have meetings down there. Why would they need to go down to Antarctica to have meetings down there? Because that's where the entities that they're meeting with have appointed themselves to meet, because that's where they come out from under, you know, the underground societies where they are, the underground civilizations where they reside. Because they've chosen not to reveal themselves unto the people of this world that live on the surface of the planet. There are many things that I've said in this video that a lot of people are going to think, wow, that's crazy. But you know what? If you don't believe it, that's between you and God. It's not my job to prove it to you. It's only my job to preach it to you. And so, like I said, if you have earnest questions about anything that I've said, if I can give you an answer, I will. Praise the Lord. If I can't, then I'll just tell you, sorry, I don't know that. But everything that I've told you is just what the Bible says, and it's also revealed in the book of Enoch, and it's also clearly revealed by internet searches for pictures and articles and whatever other information I have presented in this video. So may these things be a blessing to you. May it cause you to understand where the gods came from. There's another thing that I want to mention as well. The gods of the Romans and the Babylonians is where the Catholic religion came from, which is also the Protestant religion. The gods, which are the fallen angels, are the Trinity. They are Saturn. They are the god of the Christ Mass. They're the gods of the Ishtar festival. When people go to church on Easter morning and set their chairs outside facing the east, they are not only worshiping the sun, they are also partaking in the festival of Ishtar, which is one of these fallen angels. And that's why I began this video message in Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 17. And I'm going there right now, so I hope you'll go there with me. When people worship a trinity of gods, okay, this trinity comes from Isis, Horus, and Seb. It comes from the Egyptian trinity. It comes from the Babylonian trinity. There were civilizations of people that worshipped trinity gods hundreds of years before Jesus Christ ever came into the world. And this is why many people think that Christianity is a pagan religion, because they're confusing Christianity, those of us who believe the Bible and serve Jesus Christ, with the Roman Catholic and Protestant religions. But the fact is that the Roman Catholic and Protestant religions serve different gods than we do who are Christian. Because we who are Christians know that there is only one God, the Father, and one Lord Jesus Christ. You see, there is only one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. And God has proclaimed this from the beginning, even in the Shema, Deuteronomy 6:4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Okay? But there are many people in the world today, in fact, the vast majority of people that profess to be Christians, who still worship the Babylonian Trinity gods. And I have one right here in front of me on my screen, I think. Let me just scroll up a little bit. It's an article that I was looking at earlier. It has a picture of these three Babylonian gods, and they're called... where is it now? The names were right here, but I think it's Isis. Isis is in the middle, and then Horus is on the left side, what was the other one? I can't remember the name of it, but it doesn't really matter. Oh, here it is right in the caption under the picture. Osiris and Horus and Isis. Yeah, Osiris in the middle and Horus on the left side and Isis on the right side. And I'm at a website called ucg.org, and you can just do a Google search on this. Type it into your Google search bar, Babylonian Trinity, and lots and lots and lots of, you know, articles and pictures will come up. The Babylonians worshipped a trinity of gods. The Greeks worshipped a trinity of gods. The Romans worshipped a trinity of gods. The Medo-Persians worshipped a trinity of gods. All those nations were pagan nations that worshipped the gods, which are the fallen angels and their offspring. And that's who people are worshiping when they worship a Trinity God, because there is no such thing as a Trinity God, and no such thing is mentioned anywhere in the Bible. There's only one true God, and Jesus Christ our Lord proclaimed that when he was praying to him. And he said, "This is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent." See? So all these things, the Trinity God, the triangle symbol in religious, for religious purposes, you know, the triangle symbol is a symbol of the Trinity. All these things were present in ancient Babylon and Egypt and ancient Greece and the ancient Medo-Persian Empire, and all these empires that worshipped the gods. They worshipped devils, you see? And Saturn, one of the Roman gods, that's who people are worshipping when they partake in the Christ Mass festival, which is called Christmas, o la Navidad in Espanol. When you worship, when you fellowship or observe the Christmas festival, you're worshipping Saturn. You're worshipping a devil, okay? A fallen angel. That's who you're worshipping when you're observing Christmas. And you think it's all about Jesus. And you're so deceived because it has nothing to do with Jesus. There's no such thing as a Christmas festival in the Bible or any command from God that we should take a day and celebrate the birth of his son Jesus Christ and call it a holiday and name it after the Mass, the Christ Mass. There is no such thing in the Bible anywhere, but people do that. And a brother was telling me today that he was witnessing to people and they professed to be Christians, and they told him, "Yeah, we know that, you know, it used to be a pagan festival, but now it's been adopted by the church, and God loves us because we keep it. He knows our hearts, and he knows that we're honoring him." They know. They admit out of their mouths that they know that it is a pagan festival, and they're doing the exact same things that the sons of Aaron did when they burned strange fire unto the Lord. And what happened to those two sons of Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, when they burn strange fire before the Lord, strange incense before the Lord, or strange fire, rather. I'm speaking faster than I'm thinking, and I hate when I do that. But what happened to Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, when they burned strange fire, when they offered strange fire unto the Lord? The Lord sent fire from heaven and burned them up. He consumed them with fire. They died before the Lord. See? That's what happens to people that worship devils, even though they call their devils Jesus. It doesn't matter if you call your devils Jesus, because they're not the Lord Jesus Christ. And they that worship the Father must worship him in spirit and in truth. So now let's go back to Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 17. "They sacrificed unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not." You know, I'm going to start with verse 15. It says, "But Jeshurun waxed fat and kicked." Isn't that the case with the church nowadays, or the churches? The angel of the church of the Laodiceans that we read about in Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. And Jesus says unto them, "Thou sayest that thou art rich and increased with goods and hast need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked." And that's how people are in the churches today. They think that they're rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. They think that God has blessed them because they have a big, nice house and a fancy car and prosperity and all the things that they have need of. And you know, they have no need of anything. They've never gone a day in their lives without food. You know, they have everything that heart could wish. They're fat and flourishing, and they think that God has blessed them, but they worship devils. They go to church and they worship devils in their Christian churches. They worship devils called God the Holy Spirit, who is also Shekinah, which is the name of a devil. And their other devil god called God the Son, which doesn't exist, because there is no God called the Son. The only true and living God is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. But yet they have this other god deity that they call the Son, whom they think was co-eternal and coexistent and co-equal with God the Father. That's a Babylonian myth. That's an Egyptian myth, an old ancient Grecian myth. It has absolutely nothing to do with anything that's written in the Bible, and they are worshiping devils. "But Jeshurun waxed fat and kicked. Thou art waxen fat, thou art grown thick, thou art covered with fatness. Then he forsook God which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods, like God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. With abominations provoked they him to anger. They sacrificed unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. Which of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, ever worshipped a trinity of gods? Which of them ever worshipped a god called God the Holy Spirit, or God the Son? Which of the apostles ever made any mention of any gods that were co-equal with God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ? Which of the prophets ever mentioned any god that was co-eternal with God, the Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, that was supposedly there with him in the beginning, helping him create everything? None of that is found in the scripture anywhere. It's all ridiculous Babylonian Egyptian myth. And yet, the vast majority of people in the churches today are worshiping these devils and calling them God. And you know what they are? They're fallen angels. They're fallen angels and their offspring. That's who these people are worshiping, professing to be Christian, keeping the Christmas festival, the Ishtar festival, going to their, you know, First Trinity Church of Springfield, Illinois, or First Trinity Church of Sacramento, California, or whatever it might be. You know, Trinity Lutheran Church, Trinity Baptist Church, Trinity Pentecostal Church, Trinity this, Trinity that. It's all Babylonian myth. It has no basis in the scripture at all. Its basis is paganism. And the basis of paganism and the gods of the pagans are not made up. They're not made up myths. They are the fallen angels and their offspring. That's who the people are worshiping when they go to their Trinity churches and they keep the pagan festivals of the Romans. May this message be a blessing to those of you who love the Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. The Lord is coming soon for a church without spot or wrinkle. I hope you're a part of that church. I know I am, by the grace of God. Hallelujah. Amen.